What is going on, guys? My name is Kenji and welcome back to my channel. Hopefully it's not the first time you're watching one of my videos, but just in case it is, I'm a doctor working in London and also a biomedical science graduate. And in this video, I'll be taking you guys through the most common reason stopping doctors from gaining financial freedom. But before we start, I have to mention, I'm not talking about the 65-year-old in America working in private practice. I'm also not saying that I'm some sort of financial guru. I'll just be talking about my experience working as a doctor in the UK's National Health Service over the last 6 months, and just generally talking about the mistakes that I've made in the past and continue to make to this day as well. And also all of the conversations that I've been having with doctors and colleagues over the last couple of years whilst being in medicine. And finally, I'm not saying that doctors don't earn a good salary. I'm just purely talking about why doctors are not filthy rich like Elon Musk, or at least have some sort of financial freedom in their lives. So if you're a student or a doctor, I hope this video will help you get towards that financial goal of being financially free, or at least being better off financially in your life. So the first reason that's stopping a lot of doctors from being financially free is that their lifestyle inflates as their income increases. Now, what I mean by this is not just doctors, but a lot of people in general, is that when they're a student or before they get that job, they're not earning much money, which means they're not spending as much money. However, when they finally get that job and they get that pay increase, then they start thinking, you know what, I have a job now, I can afford better things in life, so let me buy a new car and also a new apartment. And then as their salary slowly increases over the year, their lifestyle also continues to increase to match that salary increase. So again, maybe they get promoted to a higher, you know, earning a job or a higher earning position in their company. Instead of keeping that car when they first got the job, they actually decide to upgrade to a new car because now they have more money to afford that better car. And you guys can kind of see what I'm talking about here. Even though over time a doctor's income often increases, if they're not keeping their lifestyle the same, then all that extra money is not going to gaining their financial freedom. They're not actually saving that money if they're wasting it on increasing and improving, or quote unquote, improving their lifestyle and improving the things they have in order to match that increased income. Now, in the book, The Almanac of Naval Ravikant, he often talks about how the best way to gain your financial freedom is actually to not have very much. Then all of a sudden, overnight or within a couple of weeks or months, you actually get that huge increase in income. So an example of when this might happen is when someone is actually living a very humble lifestyle, and then over the course of a couple of months to years, they actually build a company and actually manage to sell it for a very high amount. So they don't actually have that incremental increase in lifestyle as their salary increases. They actually go from having a very low expenditure lifestyle immediately to having a huge amount of money. And that's what in his book he says is the best way to gain financial freedom. However, of course, that doesn't happen to most of us. It certainly doesn't happen to me. But what we can do as our income increases is to make sure that we're not inflating our lifestyle to match that increase in income. So for me, for example, in my life, I know so many colleagues who upgrade their car every couple of years. They get the latest iPhone every single year, the latest MacBook Pro every single year, because their income is slowly increasing. What I've tried to do myself is to stick to the same exact car that I bought in my third year of medical school. And I really want to buy a new car, but I'm stopping myself and reminding myself to not increase my lifestyle as my income increases. And that's the first reason. The second reason why a lot of doctors are not financially free is that we are still limited by our hours. Now, what I mean by that is that even if you're on a very good salary, for example, when I was locuming and I was working as a locum doctor, I was earning anywhere from 40 to 60 pounds an hour, which here in the UK is actually a really good hourly rate. It's not passive, but it's fairly massive. And even though I was on a pretty good hourly rate, I was still limited by my hours. And what that means is that I'm limited also by my energy. So even though my hourly income was quite high, I still could not legally work 24 hours in a day. And obviously I need to sleep, I need to eat, I need to rest. So there's no possible way of working shifts longer than 12 hours or 12 to 13 hours. And I also can't work, you know, 7 days a week. I'm still limited by my time and my energy. Now, if you compare this, for example, to people who work in business. Business is something that is very scalable, and that's the one thing I really like about business. It's not tied to your hours. You're not actually trading your time for money. And again, in the Almanac of Ravikant, he talks about the only way to gain true financial freedom is by untying your time from your money, building a business that can scale so that even while you sleep, you're still making money. And again, as doctors, that's something that we're still limited because our time is still tied to our money, and there is no way to make money unless you're actually physically in the hospital, putting in the hours and giving up your own sort of energy and time in order to make more money. The third reason as to why a lot of doctors are not financially free is that we don't earn as much as the public actually believe we do. Now, before I actually started medical medical school, I was always told that if you want a good job, become a doctor. You'll earn so much money, you'll be rich. And unfortunately, here in the UK, that is not true. And I'm not speaking about other parts of the world like America, Australia, wherever. I'm talking about here in the UK. As a first-year doctor in the UK, I earn around £30,000 a year, which works out to be about £14 per hour. And then after tax and paying all of my national insurance and all those things like that, it actually ends up being more like £9 per hour, which is absolutely ridiculous. I actually just got my ballot in the post, and junior doctors are going to be voting to strike this year. And the reason being is that our salary has actually declined by 26% in real terms, which is a massive pay cut. So especially here in the UK, doctors are not actually paid as much as people think we are. Even if you're a consultant earning £100,000 a year, which is a really good salary, like I'm not denying that, after tax, after paying all of your costs related to, you know, keeping your status as a doctor, like all of the costs to the GMC and, you know, paying your tax, national insurance, all of those things like that, you still may only earn around £5,000 per month after tax, which is a great salary, but that's another reason as to why we're not fully financially free, because our salary isn't actually that high compared to a lot of people who are in different disciplines who may have been actually scoring the same grades as us in high school. Now, I want to take a very quick break from the video to thank Picmonic, who are kindly sponsoring the video. Now, if you guys have been watching my channel for a few years now, you know that I've been using Picmonic probably from the first or second year of medical school. And the reason why is that they're not like other resources that you have in medical school who just give you the information and expect you to know it and expect you to learn it. What Picmonic does is super unique. Picmonic is an online learning platform that gives you pictures, a story, and also a mnemonic to make learning content super easy. I'll never forget the day that I spent 5 minutes in the library using Picmonic to learn all of the bones in the hand. And just by watching that 5 minute video with the picture, the mnemonic, and the story they gave me, until this day, I'm actually able to memorize all of the bones in the hand literally from that 5 minute video. The way that I did this is by first watching the educational video, followed by the story video. And here is an example of the educational video.
Bones are described in this Picmonic by the 8 carpal bones. The mnemonic to help remember these bones is: some lovers try positions that they can't handle. Shown as the lovers trying positions until they can't handle it anymore.
So it's that unique combination between a picture, a mnemonic, and a story that really tricks your brain into learning any new content very easily. And to give you guys an example of what I mean, here is an example of the hand bone story.
And it's during times like these that some lovers try positions that they can't handle. First, they tried a new position on scaffolding, where the whole world could see just how adventurous they were. But they fell before anyone noticed. So then they went even higher, to the lunar landscape. But this position always left one lover hanging.
What else I love about Picmonic is that they have daily quizzes to check your understanding of the content that you've learned, which is super helpful. During your own background research, if you find any other information that you want to add to your Picmonic, it's actually super easy for you to edit the Picmonic and make it your own unique storyline. All of the content on Picmonic is always up to date, with students across the entire world able to add to the Picmonic database, which is superimposed by the Picmonic experts that add new information every single day. What's actually really funny is that all of the characters across the different storylines are all related, which makes it very easy to distinguish between certain facts and also tie in all of the information that you've learned. As a doctor, what's really useful is that Picmonic is also available on my MacBook, it's available on my phone, and across all of my devices. And if you guys want to check out Picmonic for yourself, then you can click the link down below in the description to get you a percentage off the premium. That's Picmonic. Let's go ahead and get back to the video. The next reason that I've seen as to why a lot of doctors are not financially free is that academically educated doesn't necessarily mean financially educated. Now, there's no denying that doctors, amongst one of the, you know, smartest people in the population, of course, become a doctor, you have to pass all of the entrance requirements, you have to do really, really well in school. So of course, these are smart people. However, just because you're an educated, smart person doesn't necessarily mean that you know how to actually manage your money. And this is the same problem that a lot of people have in our population. In our school, when we're learning, there is no class on how to, you know, manage your taxes, how to manage your credit, how to deal with debt, what is debt, how to manage your finances. It is something that is not taught at all in the British curriculum and probably the most curriculums across the entire world. So just because you know a lot about the human body, be able to make diagnoses and treatments, doesn't necessarily mean that you're financially educated or financially literate. In the exact same way as, you know, you could be a smart doctor, but maybe you're not very, you know, educated in terms of music. Maybe you don't have that, you know, musical talent, or you're not necessarily talented in terms of sports. There are different types of intelligences. And just because you have the intelligence to be a doctor doesn't necessarily mean you have the intelligence to manage your own money. Honestly, in my experience of medicine over the last 6 years, I've seen so many doctors who are so smart and I really look up to them and I'm like, you're my consultant. I really admire you. You're so smart. But I know that person is in financial debt. I know they're really struggling to manage their finances. And when you think about it, and you know, on my way out from the hospital, I see they're driving a supercar. It just doesn't add up. It doesn't make sense. And this is why I think it's super important for anybody, not just medical students or doctors, to try their best to set aside time every single day to be financially educated. You can literally read a few books, you can read a few articles online, and really learn about how to manage your finances so that when you do have that high income salary, you know how to manage it. So you have savings, you can make investments, you can start a business, you can do whatever to put yourself in a better financial position, and that will really help you and your family in the future. The next reason is that as doctor, we have little to no time to do anything else other than work in a hospital and look after our patients. And I'm just speaking purely from my position again. As a junior doctor, I often work from 9 to 5, sometimes from 8:30 to 9:30. I work long shifts, we work night shifts, we work weekends, and that can be incredibly exhausting. Now, as you guys know, I love YouTube so much. This YouTube really is my side hustle. You know, I do it as a passion, but I also really enjoy the business aspect of things. And as a doctor, it's been super hard to do anything else other than medicine. I actually feel like I live in the hospital, and filming these YouTube videos for you guys has been incredibly difficult, if I'm quite honest. And now making these YouTube videos for you guys, I'm really struggling to find time to actually do this, because as a doctor, personally, I feel like I have no time to do anything else that could contribute to building my own financial wealth. Now, again, if you want to be a doctor full-time, that's completely fine. But in order to build true wealth, in order to gain true financial freedom and true financial stability, you do have to do things outside of medicine that will help you build true financial wealth. Again, that might be to start a side hustle. It might be to establish a business. But staying and working in the UK's National Health Service will definitely fund my life and it will help me build a very good life, but it might be very difficult in order to gain that financial freedom. Now, to be completely honest with you guys, when I'm on the wards and I see consultants who are in their 70s, sometimes in their late 60s, right now, currently the NHS retirement age is 67. You know, I often ask myself this question. I often say, you know, why is that, you know? And actually, when I ask a lot of doctors on my ward every single day, if they won the lottery, would they still do medicine? The vast majority of doctors actually say no, they would quit immediately. Some doctors, maybe 5 to 10% of doctors that I've asked, often answer that they would work part-time, maybe only work 1 to 2 days a week. Then I often follow them up with a question, which is, so why are you still here? Why are you still working? And they say, because of my mortgage, because of the bills I have to pay. And again, that is the life that I see in the future if I don't continue to work in other ways to build true financial wealth. Now, there's nothing wrong with being a full-time doctor. I'm just purely speaking about the financial freedom side of things. The next reason that's getting in our way of building true financial wealth is the late start to our career. Now, talking about my story again, I didn't actually start earning money in my career until I reached 26, and I'm almost 27 now, actually. I spent the first 8 years of my life purely in higher education. Of course, I was working a few jobs here and there as a bartender, as a waiter, but I didn't actually start earning a full-time salary until I was 26 years old, which again is 8 years later. Now, this is in comparison to a lot of my friends who did a 3-year degree, left university at 21, and hadn't been working for the last 5 years. And after this experience of 5 years, a lot of my friends who scored the same grades that I did in high school are now earning 80, 90, 100,000 pounds in a different field. Now, I'm not complaining, this is the life that I chose, but I'm just explaining to you guys that a lot of doctors don't actually start earning in their careers until well into their 20s, into their mid-20s, and oftentimes, sometimes into their late 20s or 30s. Now, this late start in their life, again, kind of puts them a step back in terms of gaining true financial freedom, because we don't have those added early years to actually build our careers, build our financial wealth, and you know, establish financial freedom. Now, of course, this changes when you do go through the ranks and you do become a more senior doctor. Of course, your salary does tend to increase, but I'm purely talking about the perspective of a lot of my friends who went into different fields, who were, you know, educated as much as I was, equally, who are scoring the same grades as much as I was. And again, I'm not complaining. This is the life that I chose, but I'm just saying that that late start in our career, that late start into our life, definitely affects our potential in regards to financial freedom. And the final reason that makes it really hard for doctors to be rich is the high student loan and financial debt. Now, talking purely from my perspective again, I'm in over £100,000 of debt in the UK. Now, of course, this is to the student finance company. This doesn't classify as personal debt, but this will be a loan that I will have to continue paying until I reach, you know, £0 or for the next 30 years. Right now, because I am locuming on the side and I am working as a doctor, I'm paying around £250 per month back to pay my student loan. And I'll be doing so for the next, you know, decade or two decades. I don't actually know how long it'll be, but it'll be a bloody long time. Now, I'd actually put myself in a pretty good position. A lot of people that I know didn't just rack up student debt to the government. They actually, you know, racked up a huge amount of personal debt from credit cards and personal loans just to try and get through the long years of medical school. Now, this I hear is particularly a problem in America where the tuition fee loan system works differently, but at least here in the UK, so many of the people that I know have also taken on personal financial debt in order to get their way through medical school because they often have degrees before that. They have, you know, 5 years medical school, and then some people also do degrees after that. So if you're someone who got into personal debt as well as your tuition fee debt, it can be incredibly hard to come out of this, and you'll often spend the first few years as a doctor working to try and pay that financial tuition fee back and also all the personal loans. And those are all the reasons that I think are standing in my own way of gaining my financial freedom. I hope this has given you another perspective of how to think about when you're working in your career or working as a doctor or whatever field you're in. These are definitely the things that I've written down for myself as well to think about to make sure that I don't get in this financial debt, I don't get into a bad financial position, that I'm actually able to move forward and hopefully build some sort of financial freedom along my career. If this video has helped you in any way at all or given you any new insights at all, please drop a video a like, make sure you subscribe with notifications on. Thank you guys so much for watching. Before you leave, here is another video on my channel that you may actually like and enjoy. Thank you so much for watching, and I'll see you on the next one.